Hey guys, welcome to another little Watchmen video. This time we got a little bit different of a setup here because we're going to be discussing what makes a horror movie great or good, anything like that. No?
Now, my good pal Riley and I, we've seen a fair share of horror movies. A lot of them we've watched together.
Yep.
And a majority are not very good.
No. We've been watching hundreds of them since like, we were in like 8th grade, and like a very small few of them are memorable, I would say.
Yeah. They're either very bad or
mediocre.
Okay, and you just kind of forget about them.
Yeah.
And there's a few, every maybe 10, mm-hmm. 10 or 15 or so, that's pretty good.
Pretty good, yeah.
It's so rare, though. We thought, since I know that all of the famous horror movie directors are out there watching this video.
Yeah, they all are.
That we could give you some pointers.
Little advice of how to...
What we think makes a good...
And what we think is the right way.
Solid horror film.
That's right. So the first thing we were going to try to talk about here, we want to talk about the importance of steering away from predictable jump scares or anything of the sort, because when you have... especially with blockbuster horror, like even like the most recent Nun is a good example, where you have characters going down hallways or corridors, where you have the camera panning behind their shoulders, behind them as they're looking in certain directions, and then you just know based on how slow or how fast it's going, whether or not there's going to be something, oh, right there, ready to jump scare
you, yeah,
with a loud, huge sound for no apparent reason.
Jump scares in... not very good horror movies are often telegraphed.
Mm-hmm.
So a couple examples that we wrote down are, you know, whenever you see a character looking through
a tiny peephole. Or like a keyhole or
where
something.
Where the camera's just in a very...
little tiny condensed
You know
space.
Something's going to pop
Someone's
out.
Gonna something's
going to
be right
gonna happen.
There. You just know it.
Another thing that you commonly see in horror movies is when, like, say a character's at the fridge... and it's to their
well, it's not
their
even, they
side.
Don't even do that just in horror movies. Actually, they do it sometimes as a joke, you know, like when it's not actually
but
an
it's,
evil
it's
character.
But it's oftentimes yeah. in horror where the camera's to the side, they're opening the fridge, the door's blocking.
And when
what's
they close
to the
it?
Next to them, when they close it, something's there.
Mm-hmm.
Jump scares can be effective. They're not my favorite. I don't think they're...
For creating interest in a horror movie, but... I'd say they're valuable sometimes because they really,
they're
obviously
well
it's a
placed,
sense of shock when
if
you're
they're
watching.
Well placed, they can be great. But oftentimes in horror movies, you can see them coming, so it takes away any jump.
Yeah, any movie that's trying its best to be The Conjuring or even Insidious is probably the best example for stuff like that, that just plasters the whole thing with a heavy focus on scares instead of anything deeper, like the characters, which is another thing. We want to talk about, like, the... usually there's a heavy neglect when it comes to writing. Even, like, semi-decent writing for the characters. And the way an ensemble of characters interact with each other, it's usually either cringy to almost fairly mediocre in a lot of, like, their motivations, too,
yeah.
for why they're doing certain things.
A lot, like,
but,
when we were coming up with things to talk about, one of the things when we were talking about what to come up with... one of the things that I said that I thought is that this kind of relates to writing and just storytelling in horror
mm-hmm.
movies particular. It's not like a drama or it's not like a romantic movie where they're really focused on the characters and the story.
They should be.
I know. I'm saying
yeah.
in a lot of these horror movies, they just kind of throw
yes,
that
they neglect that
out the window and they just act like...
They hope that what draws people is the scare factor, which
so
like
my,
we were just talking about, is predictable in the first place.
Right. So my analogy is that horror movies are like treated like of just a purely visual haunted house sometimes. Bad horror movies where, you know, haunted houses, there's not usually story. There's not
mm-hmm.
characters. They just throw things in to try and scare you.
Yeah.
And that's one thing that you notice in really good or strong horror movies.
Like,
to me, that's one of the things
yeah.
that stands
I think
out.
The best thing you need, I would say, probably one of the most important things in horror, besides the creepy atmosphere, is you need, like I said, well-rounded characters that feel fairly realistic and are relatable, those are probably the most important ones you need. Because then you care for them when they're in these stressful situations and stuff. And not just like, where it's more about you feel bad when the main character is getting scared instead of the film focusing on getting the audience to jump. If you know what I'm saying? And but like, a really good example of, it's actually the series. I know you started, even finished yet, but Haunting of Hill House does a great job of, sure, they have a focus on some of the scares and the creepy atmosphere to the whole thing, but they do a great job of focusing on grounded and really interesting characters that have a really intriguing way of how they interact with one another, which is what compels you to want to know what happens next in their family story.
And same kind of thing with, we've talked about this movie a couple times, but Hereditary is another movie that does a really good job of... it focuses a lot on the characters, and I think that's one reason why it's really effective, is because, like a lot of these horror movies, they don't just kind of say screw it to the main characters. They teach you about them, and you learn about these characters.
You feel for them when you get into these gut-wrenching situations where they're just being mistreated by, I don't know, a demon or a killer or whatever it might be.
And that's why we think, you know, that's why that movie's so effective, is because not only the scares work, but the scares work extra well because you care about the characters.
You have compelling, well-written, and well-rounded characters.
It's like we've said before, it's a family drama first, horror second, and I think that's...
That works for its benefit, for sure.
The next kind of category we want to talk about is good horror movies are... They create their own atmosphere, or they create a unique atmosphere, or they're atmospheric in a way that it draws you into the story.
Or could even make you feel uncomfortable at times, too, to connect with the horror aspect of it, which is always... sometimes it can be a good thing if you're feeling uncomfortable during a movie, but also being uncomfortable can make you be more, I would say, hooked into suspenseful situations in movies, like
some examples that we have. There's It Follows. It has a really unique atmosphere, and it ties into the story. The Witch
is super very, atmospheric. Very, 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 very atmospheric. Yeah, you have it's a lot of these people. These what is it like late 1600s? Then when this is taking place, where you're more being drowned in their own sense of hysteria. And fear of the unknown.
A feeling of dread.
It's not really about seeing the witch. It's more about the horror comes from, feeling of dread of how their hysteria is making the horror in the first place. And their tension between one another of worrying about who's a witch and who isn't.
And another good example of this, I think, is the Austrian movie Goodnight Mommy, which is... I'd say
very atmospheric.
It's not very well known. It kind of went viral when the trailer came out, just because the trailer was pretty creepy. But then I think people kind of forgot about it. But if you sit down and watch that movie, it's super. It just kind of gets under your skin. It makes you feel weird. It makes you feel uncomfortable. You don't know what's gonna happen next. And for a movie like this, I think it's really important for horror. And I think another movie. That it doesn't make you feel uncomfortable, but the atmosphere is Paranormal Activity. The atmosphere
that's good about that's more of like a connection with pacing too. Is where you have moments of relief is important. I think sometimes where a continuous sense of when you're not sure if something's gonna happen or not is good. It's possible that it can be good. It can be done well, but when it comes to Paranormal Activity, which is probably one of the earliest examples, not earliest, but like it's a good example of not just found footage, but I'm just saying like where you have, you know, when it hits nighttime, something awful or creepy is going to happen, that people are already on edge just based on being fine-tuned to that time of day, or knowing that, well, God, now it's nighttime.
And when it's going to go down. When it is night in the Paranormal Activity movie, specifically the first, they do a great job of just making you feel on edge the whole night, wondering about what's going to happen, is something paranormal going to happen. Atmosphere, it also helps ramp up scares, and if you have...
builds builds suspense overall.
Right. So we think that's in most good horror movies, they have a unique, or at least the atmosphere about them is.
It gives them their own tone. It's very difficult to describe, but when you see movies like some of the ones we were talking about, you'll understand perfectly what we're talking about.
Right.
When it comes to the atmosphere. But when it comes to, because another thing we were talking about some of the suspense and some of just overall creepy tones from certain movies that do just a great job, or you have a moment where it could just be like, you sort of have that ambient bass sound where you know something's there. If you guys know what I mean, like where it's just like this bass is just constantly hitting you from the speakers, that's just making you feel uncomfortable, or like something evil is present with you, or something's here, or it's upon you. Like, we're going to show a few scenes from certain parts from different movies, but there's a scene from The Canal where the guy is in the bathroom. The movie overall is fairly forgettable. I don't really remember much, but this scene is pretty suspenseful and really interesting to watch. What's a moment, another movie you're thinking of?
This kind of ties into this whole topic of just kind of suspenseful, creepy moments, ties into atmosphere. But one of the moments that sticks out in my head that we have written down is from the first Insidious, where the dad goes into the spirit realm place to try to find his son. And he enters this house, and there's these strange people sitting in this foggy room that just have smiles on their face. They almost look like mannequins, but they're people.
Yeah.
And the mix of that, the visuals, the music, everything, it's a successful scene. And we'll play a clip if you haven't seen it, so you know what we're talking about.
You're also not quite sure what they're going to do when you approach them. And then another good example too is in Insidious 2, actually, is when this is in the second one, but there's a handful of moments in movies where I'm just like, I get really creeped out. I'm like, oh god, this shit's creepy, dude. And like, there's this one moment in Insidious 2 where this where the boy is the main kid is playing, originally they set up earlier where he's playing telephone with his brother with a can and a string while they're sitting in bed. They're in the same bedroom. But then she hears someone talking into the can, assuming it's her brother, then just finding out that the can and the string is leading into the closet, and he's like, oh, shit, something's in there. And then then this creepy woman comes out of the closet crying, and she's like all soaking wet, and it's really creepy and very atmospheric, as you can just feel and sense his heartbeat like getting faster and faster as he's freaking out. And then as the camera as the camera slowly zooms in on the creepy figure, as it's like freaking out itself, as it's about to turn around to reveal itself, that moments like that are cool. And I know there's one scene that you and I both agree on, and what's that? From a little movie called Gerald's Game.
Oh yeah, Gerald's Game is actually, I think, kind of a hidden gem for horror.
It's true.
It kind of just came out of nowhere on Netflix. Mm-hmm. And I sat down.
Netflix.
and watched it one time, and I was actually really surprised. Gerald's Game's a great movie, but there's this character, sorry, spoiler if you haven't seen it, it doesn't give away all that much, but there's this character, the Moonlight Man, and just, Gerald's Game does a great job when he's first introduced of not showing too much of him to kind of leave your imagination. Kind of like if you were a kid in bed and you thought you saw something in the corner of your room and your mind starts kind of playing tricks. Gerald's Game does a great job of not showing you too much, but showing you just enough.
Well, making you wonder whether or not what she is seeing is real or not is what also is super intriguing. Right. But yeah, Moonlight Man, he creepy. We'll show you the scene that we're talking about.
And then last thing we wanted to talk about before we do a little wrap-up and summary of all the things that we talked about today.
Mm-hmm.
another thing, and this is kind of... A lot of these things can be put into place for all movies in general. Like atmosphere and good characters, solid characters, and this last category, music. These are things that can be applied to any movie to make any movie better. But we think that for horror movies specifically, the music is very important. It's important in every genre, but in
during
horror,
those super intense moments especially.
If you can find a good and quality song that fits the scene well,
mm-hmm.
That can add a lot more suspense to your movie.
Probably the best example we have of it is from Hereditary at the very end. I don't want to show the scene because, for the most part, it's the direct ending of the scene since the movie itself is fairly new. And I know some people are going to want to watch it.
It would give away a lot.
It'll give away a lot. But on a plate, we'll show, like...
A little snippet of the song.
A little bit of the song in here, but...
It's a super smart song, because after you watch the movie, I kind of looked up and I wanted to know more. And the song itself, I'm going to try to leave it as broad as possible, but the song itself...
Matches with key... this is what I would say, sorry.
I
would just say that it matches with key points addressed in the movie. That's all I really want to say.
Yeah. And if you finish the movie and you look up the song and you look up more about the song and more about the character that it's tying into, you'll see it's just really smart.
It's cool. It's weird and it's cool and it's a great...
And it fits the movie well.
Feeling for the end.
And another thing that we wanted to talk about related to music is the lack of music in horror movies.
Mm-hmm. Or just dead silence too. It's important.
An example that comes to mind is in Sinister... When Ethan Hawke is in the, like, going through his house looking for...
The first one. Oh, yeah. That's the only one he's in. Never mind.
Yeah. When he's going through his house kind of, like, looking... He hears something. He's, like, looking for spirits or whatever. It's, like, dead silent. And silence in horror movies, I think, is almost equally as important as finding a good song. Mm-hmm. Because both can play into the intensity and both can be...
That's right.
And we keep referencing Insidious. There's another great use of music, A Tiptoe Through the Tulips.
Oh, that's just a weird song.
In the first Insidious. It's a weird song, and it's a weird part in the movie, and it just...
Tiptoe!
It adds a lot.
Tulips.
It's
a weird-ass song. That's true. But, yeah, for the most part, we just wanted to share with you guys some of the moments and the best moments in a horror movie to help make it a well-rounded... piece of art.
There's the avoid telegraphed jump scares like we talked
mm-hmm.
about.
And heavy, yeah.
Positive characters and good writing.
I don't know about positive, but just well written.
I just mean don't throw your characters out the window just because it's a horror movie.
Sure.
You want to make sure that you develop and you have a solid base.
Try your best to have a unique atmosphere with a movie. That's important too.
And the atmosphere ties into those creepy moments that we were talking about. A good atmosphere is gonna allow you to do a lot more.
Yeah, and help build suspense in certain moments.
Right, and then, like we just talked about last, is music or lack of music. A good soundtrack or knowing when to play silence in a horror movie, I think,
is super important. Cinematography is important, too, but there's not a whole lot we're going to talk about.
Cinematography, I mean, that goes for any movie.
Hand in hand for any movie, but I'm saying, yeah, either way. But, so, there we go. Hope you guys find a good little horror movie. If you do, you know, let us know.
Whoever's watching, if you like this type of
movie. Whatever
small
number of people are.
If you like this type of movie. If you like this type of video where we talk about genres or talk about types of movies, let us know.
Yeah.
We're open to anything that the viewers want to see. Thank you for joining us today, and we'll see you next time here on The Watchmen.